got started. This is the huge success story with cytoreduction and HIFU. Now you can see here how I'm dissecting. It seems, I've been told, it's a little bit like painting with watercolors. You kind of only know where you're going by where you've been. Putting a lot of traction on the peritoneum here, and just laying this electrosurgical ball pit on pure cut right at the interface of the peritoneum. And this particular patient, we had to do the complete anterior parietal peritoneum. You can do it, you know. I was taught in Boston when I was in my surgical training that the peritoneum was somehow or other sacred, that you should not remove it. You know, we always reconstructed the peritoneum of the abdominal wall. Now, you don't need peritoneum. The human body with the food that we have now survives just as well with or without peritoneum. It's the huge and heavy fibrosis that you get if you have an infectious problem that can give you problems. So here I think now I'm working up underneath the right hemi diaphragm, and then can the lights go down at all? Can we dim the lights? Is this in here? How do we get the lights down? You'll be able to see this much better with... is this it right here? So, this is the... right paracolic sulcus, and we've taken down the undersurface of the right hemi diaphragm. We will remove the tumor. I usually take the ball tip and kind of bend it, make a so-called hockey stick out of the electrosurgical tip, and thereby use it to perform Glisson's capsulectomy. Well, that's much better, and the more you can reduce the light, the better. So let's start here. Here we are at the undersurface of the right hemi diaphragm. You can see that I'm putting rather profound traction on this diaphragm here. It's actually easier to do a diaphragm that's infiltrated by the malignant process than one that is not, because it's more firm, you can put more traction on it. And as you can see, what I'm leaving behind here, the undersurface of the right hemi diaphragm, is totally and completely functional. We did some studies trying to determine what the problems with diaphragm function are postoperatively. We couldn't identify any. So when you do this kind of dissection, the postoperative care, extubation 2 or 3 hours after the surgery and the like, is the same. So not only do I use the ball tip, but with profound traction, I can actually bluntly strip a lot of the... Now, here I'm out at the lateral arcuate ligament, and I'm just dividing the peritoneum, the 12th rib will be right here, dividing that peritoneum out at the lateral arcuate ligament, and I'm going to get my finger underneath to go all the way along, and we'll actually define a lateral and a medial subperitoneal space. And you'll see we're going to remove this rather large mass of tumor completely from the undersurface of the right hemi diaphragm, and we're going to actually do it bloodlessly. Once you get to the bare area of the diaphragm, the connections between the peritoneum and the undersurface of the diaphragm are quite loose. And now this is important. So See that thing right there? Let's not get in trouble with that. That is the left hepatic vein. And so we're visualizing directly the left hepatic vein, and then in a counterclockwise manner, we're releasing the peritoneal reflection of the liver and the undersurface of the left hemi diaphragm. And so this is then finally removing that specimen that's been taken out from the undersurface of the right hemi diaphragm, from the right retrohepatic space. And yet here we're in the right retrohepatic space. Okay, someone in the surgical team says, okay, Sugar Baker, watch out for the adrenal. There's the adrenal gland right there. If you're not seeing well what you're doing, you can damage either the right or left adrenal gland. You can see the adrenal gland right here. If you pull too hard on it, it's going to hemorrhage. And then once it gets bleeding, you can't get it to stop, and you often have to remove it. That shouldn't happen very often. So this is the right hepatorenal space that is virtually always heavily involved, and we're resecting it in total. Here we're working from the right hemi diaphragm down the right paracolic sulcus. We're getting rid of all of the disease in the hepatorenal pouch, or pouch of Morrison. And as you can see, we're doing it relatively bloodlessly. This patient, this was done about 6 years ago. She's alive and well. And I think she had 2 units of blood and 4 units of fresh frozen plasma. Sometimes we use more plasma than we use the blood. Okay, this is what comes out from underneath the right hemi diaphragm. Now, you're not going to, with the CUSA or with some sort of scraping and the like, you're not going to be able to do that sort of complete dissection. And as you can see, this is the anterior lateral branch of the inferophrenic artery and vein. It's intact, and no damage to the right hepatic vein. And so we're happy. We usually do the anterior parietal perineum first. Then we do the right hemi diaphragm. And now we're going to move over to the left side. And it's a lot of the same on the left side. There are actually quite some real differences in the vascular anatomy of the undersurface in the right and the left hemi diaphragm. But here you can see we're using basically the same technique. The electrosurgery is on pure cut at high voltage. It's about time for me to irrigate. It gets too hot if you don't frequently irrigate with room temperature saline. The saline irrigation is good not only in that it cools down the sites, especially if you're working around tubular structures, but it clears away the debris, so that I've got complete visualization of the operative site. Now here again, we're able to do some blunt dissection of the peritoneal surface from the undersurface of the left hemi diaphragm, especially in and around the central tendon. And if it doesn't strip, then you've got to remove the central tendon. It's very unusual to have to do resections of the muscular portion of the hemi diaphragm. And if you remove the entire central tendon, you don't need prosthetic material. You just flatten the diaphragm. You know, the diaphragm is a beautiful cupola, and as you repair it, you just flatten it a little bit. The patient will have, in that situation, some respiratory problems, but nothing that is requiring long-term ventilatory support. You can see we've already done. We've We've already done the great omentectomy here in order to get it out of the way. So, all right, we did the anterior parietal peritoneum. We did the right hemidiaphragm. Now we've completed the left hemidiaphragm. And we're going to go, of course, to the pelvis. So we're going to release the peritoneum from the posterior rectus sheath. And then begin as we normally would this centripetal approach. So here we're in the right paracolic sulcus going down into the right side of the pelvis. We'll get underneath now we're going over, we're on the left side. So we're right in and around the ureter. There is the ureter right there. Okay, so my assistant, Dr. Bajelic, is irrigating frequently because this is very hot, high-voltage electrosurgical dissection, and the ureter is one of our precious structures. So this is the bladder, and the bladder is held up on an Allis clamp by the uretus. Try not to put the clamp on the muscular surface of the bladder itself. And so the dissection proceeds with traction on the bladder. And now this is the left uterine artery. We're going to suture ligate it. Proximally and distally. You don't need to call in your gynecologic oncology colleague unless you just want to be politically correct. If you want to be politically correct, then they will come in and do the hysterectomy. And sometimes we do have GYN people come in and do it, but usually I do this myself. I actually like to get them involved. One of our major efforts at the hospital center is to bring GYN oncology and surgical oncology together. Because they have things that I can learn from them, and they've got some things they can learn from me. So here, these are the sutures on the right and left uterine arteries. Again, a fair amount of room temperature irrigation. I've now cleared the pararectal fossa, or the peritoneum that's above the pararectal fossa, and we're now entering the vagina anteriorly, doing it under a direct vision. Now, that structure usually bleeds. Vagina is a very vascular structure. But with this high-voltage electrosurgical dissection, we can go through the vagina with good control of the uterine vessels. We can go through it basically in a bloodless manner. Now, this is a very important part of the procedure because a lot of people leave tumor behind either in the rectovesical space in the male or the rectouterine space in the female. So here I'm going to grab the posterior, you probably do this all the time also, but grab the posterior aspect of the vagina and then place traction on the rectum. Keep the rectum on traction. If you don't, you're gonna stumble into the lumen of the rectum. And here, going around, now finishing off the dissection of the peritoneum beneath the pararectal fossa. And now continuing up, and I'm actually now skeletonizing the lower two-thirds of the rectum. So that if I have to transect the rectum, I'm going to do it at the junction of middle and upper rectum, and I'm not going to need an ostomy. Very unusual for us to do a diverting ostomy in this group of patients. Keep all those structures on stretch. You get a good idea there as to the technology that I'm using. And you know, some people like to use the electrosurgical forceps. You can see here it's the middle rectum that's been skeletonized. And again, you know, there's a large volume of disease here on the pelvic peritoneum, especially in the cul-de-sac, and this is the only way you're going to be able to get rid of that disease. Now, you ask me, in this particular patient, who had virtually no disease on her small bowel, and a complete removal of the parietal peritoneum, did she need HIPEC? I don't really know. But I can tell you the standard of care is to use cytoreduction and then the hypothermic intraperitoneal chemotherapy. So this was a visceral sparing pelvic peritoneectomy. Now, we had a question about the porta hepatis. Okay? It's the toughest of the peritoneectomy procedures. Of course, what you're going to do first is a removal of the gastrohepatic ligament. Start with the cholecystectomy. The gallbladder, in some respects, opens up the lesser omental bursectomy procedure. This is just simply doing a... do I always remove the gallbladder? Well, almost always. And the reason is that you get into trouble with the gallbladder 2 and 3 and 4 years later. Just about everybody seems to develop stones. And so I think it's quite important to remove the gallbladder, not only because it facilitates the dissection, but now, remember I talked about this profound digital compression of the arcade made up by the right and left gastric arteries. So I'm being very patient. I am using digital dissection to move the fatty tissues and the tumor off of the vessels because it's very nice in terms of postoperative function to have spared both the right and the left gastric arteries. You've got to watch for the right gastric artery. It's very superficial under the peritoneum. If you're not thinking about it, you're going to go through it. Okay, this is the ductus venosus right here. This is the fissure defined by the ductus venosus. You can see you've almost always dissected out. And be careful because as the ductus venosus goes up to the left hepatic vein, it's sometimes wide open. So if you cut the ductus venosus off the left hepatic vein, you can get a huge hemorrhage that you didn't expect. So watch out for the ductus venosus. Either spare it or tie it off as it goes into the left hepatic vein. Now, this is the hepatoduodenal ligament. I've divided the peritoneal reflection here on the liver. And you can see there's several nodules of the tumor there. So with a little patience and a little persistence, good instrument to use here is the Russian forceps. So here I'm stripping the anterior aspect of the hepatoduodenal ligament, doing it completely, and you will see that in a few minutes I'm going to look underneath the posterior aspect of the hepatoduodenal ligament. Here's just some little bits of... this is the right gastric artery right here. I'm pulling off with the Russian forceps some little strands of tissue and mucus. And I'm going to make sure I look up underneath the structures of the porta hepatis to clean out. Here you can see the caudate lobe now. To clean out the inferior aspect of the hepatoduodenal ligament. One of the most common sites for recurrence is the tissue underneath the porta hepatis. People just don't look under there, and then unfortunately, later on, the patient comes back with obstruction of the left hepatic duct, and so that's the tissue from underneath the porta hepatis. This is just a rather large lymphatic going out of the porta hepatis and into the hepatogastric ligament. Now, this is very, very hot electrosurgical dissection, and absence of any hemorrhage as these structures are transected. So a final step is now to elevate the left caudate lobe. I'm just now kind of neatening up in that area, so I've got to elevate the left caudate lobe of the liver, and now I need to strip out the floor of the omental bursa. Now, the gastric cancer surgeons are quite good at this. But if you've been trained as a colorectal surgeon, this is going to Brendan Moran and the group in Basingstoke. We had to review quite extensively how to do, because you see all this mucus gets caught up here in the omental bursa area. So we're dividing the peritoneal reflection from beneath the caudate lobe and just on top of the vena cava. Now, you don't have to do this in all cytoreductions, right? This is a pseudomyxoma cytoreduction. The disease is all over the place. And again, here I've divided the peritoneal reflection, and then I'm getting out to my Russian forceps, and I'm peeling away the peritoneum. This is the area of the adductus venosus right here. Watch out for it, or you can cause a lot of bleeding up in this area. There's a left hepatic vein right there, and then a fair amount of blunt dissection. If you leave disease behind in that superior recess of the omental bursa, you're going to get a recurrence. And going back there is tough, very tough, near impossible. So now we're continuing the centripetal surgery. This is the stomach right here. This is the crust of the right hem, crust of the right hemidiaphragm. We've skeletonized that. And this procedure, you can see here, the lesser omental tissue. It's filled with mucinous tumor. And this is the final effort now. This is the stomach up here. And we're basically connecting our points A and B. A lot of branches of the anterior vagus nerve that are being divided. I used to worry about that, but I don't worry about it at all anymore. You may have some delayed gastric emptying, but just put in a nasogastric tube and do not do the pyloroplasty or a gastric duodenostomy. And this is the specimen then that's removed. Lots of the tumor nodules there. Again, there's just no way to do this unless you do the lesser omental resection and omental resection. And the complete dissection here from the textbook. Okay. I think I'll stop there. And hopefully I've given you some idea as to what I think cytoreductive surgery and hypothermic intraperitoneal chemotherapy is all about.